So today we're going to talk about arrhythmias and how they relate to excessive amounts of calcium stuck inside your cell. Now, arrhythmias relate to a problem with the rhythm of your heart. It could be a minor palpitation. It could be a major atrial fibrillation. But anything that is abnormal from the regular rhythm of the heartbeat is called arrhythmias. Now, I will say there's other reasons for arrhythmias, like hyperthyroidism. That could be one. But when I'm done with this presentation, all roads lead to excessive calcium inside your cells. This is why one of the medications they may use for arrhythmias would be a calcium channel blocker. Now, calcium is just one of the electrolytes that you have in your body. Electrolytes are those electrically charged minerals that help conduct electricity through the body, through the nervous system, and that can activate muscles. So you have sodium as an electrolyte, and that can act as a spark. And calcium has to do with the squeeze or contraction of the heart. And then the relaxation phase is controlled by magnesium. Now, there's many triggers to palpitations, heart arrhythmias, which, by the way, many times occur more at night during the day. But you have caffeine, for example. That would be obviously during the day. Now, why would caffeine trigger an arrhythmia or a palpitation? Simply because it alters calcium physiology. Same thing with alcohol. It alters calcium in the body. Sugar will do it. Stress will do it, as in cortisol. Certain electrolytes affect calcium. Low vitamin D can affect calcium for sure. And there's certain chemicals in chocolate that can alter the calcium. And this is why a lot of people notice that after consuming chocolate, or even caffeine or alcohol or sugar, or going through stress, they feel like a little palpitation in the heart, or the heart skips a beat, things like that. And then there are certain drugs that alter calcium. Two specifically are the antipsychotic drugs and the antidepressant drugs. Both drive calcium inside the cell and increase the risk for arrhythmias, which could actually lead to sudden death. So you can look at these as triggers. So now the question is, how do we make sure we don't have excessive amounts of calcium inside your cells? Well, one of the biggest controllers of preventing calcium inside the cell would be this mineral right here, magnesium. Magnesium is one of the primary controllers of calcium and preventing too much from getting inside the cell. Magnesium is also involved in keeping your potassium high outside the cell, when normally it's supposed to be inside the cell. And also, magnesium is supposed to be inside the cell, like 99% of it is supposed to be inside, and only 1% should be outside. And this leads to another problem of testing. When you check your blood for magnesium levels, you're really only testing 1% of all of the body's magnesium, and this is the worst place to test magnesium. You really want to do an intracellular test. I will put a link down below of a good lab. I had mine done recently, and it did come out normal. There's also a tremendous amount of people that have a magnesium deficiency. It's subclinical, so they may not have a lot of symptoms. They may have one or two. Magnesium is also involved in keeping sodium low inside the cell, as well as calcium. So it wants to keep calcium and magnesium out of the cell and potassium inside the cell. Any type of imbalance with these electrolytes throws off the entire electrical system of the body. And this is where you get like a short-circuiting effect, which basically describes an arrhythmia. A couple reasons why you might be magnesium deficient. It could be that you're consuming too many refined carbs or sugar, or have insulin resistance, or you're pre-diabetic or you're diabetic. All of those will keep magnesium low. Could be that you're not consuming enough magnesium from your diet because you don't like vegetables. By the way, most of the magnesium in the food supply is in the leafy greens, because green is part of the chlorophyll complex and magnesium is at the center of it. There's also a very important pump that allows these mineral exchanges to happen. And each one of your cells has billions of these sodium-potassium pumps. And these are very important in allowing magnesium, other electrolytes to be traveled through this exchange mechanism. And then to reverse that, if you don't have enough magnesium, potassium and sodium won't work as well. So as you can see, it gets really complex, but don't worry, it's going to get more complex because there's a vitamin K2, which also has an effect on calcium. Vitamin K2 helps to take the calcium which is in the wrong place in your body, the soft tissues, like in the heart, on the nerves, in the joints, in the kidney, and push that in back into the bone. So having enough K2 can also protect excessive calcium with inside the cell. Also, vitamin D3 helps to alter calcium and reduce the risk of arrhythmias. But what I wanted to tell you in this video is that there's a core problem with arrhythmias, and it has to do with excessive calcium in the wrong place. And there's many different triggers that can cause this. So what you probably should do to figure this out is to scan through the various things that I said and see if you're doing too much caffeine, too much alcohol, too much sugar, have too much stress, or maybe you're not getting enough magnesium, which is probably one of the biggest factors. Or let's say you're low in vitamin D, or you're eating too much chocolate, or you're taking drugs that have side effects. That's what you need to do, is look through those and see if you can correct that to put your heart back in rhythm. And the other thing I would recommend is, instead of trying to take one mineral to try to correct it, consume food that has all the minerals in the right proportions. That would be the ideal scene. But you would need to consume about 7 to 10 cups of vegetables per day to start to build up those minerals. Now, you can also do electrolyte powder that has all of them in there. And realize that it does take some time. It could take 3 to 4, possibly 5 months to remineralize your body if you're very deficient. Don't forget about vitamin K2 and D3 as well. Thanks for watching, and I have another video on electrolytes that you may be interested in. I put it right here.